Welcome back to Archaeology After Dark, everybody. I am, of course, your host, Daniel Rhodes. My guest today is Amanda McBride. Amanda, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
So, in continuing with our theme of Archaeology Month, we're going to touch on another topic, Section 106. Amanda, tell us a little bit about yourself and about what we're talking about today.
Well, as you said, my name is Amanda McBride. I'm originally from the Gulf Coast in South Baldwin County. I graduated from Troy University way back in 1997. And as a kid, I was always fascinated with archaeology. Like a lot of kids, I wanted to grow up to be an archaeologist, and it never, ever occurred to me that I could actually do that. And until I took an electives course in anthropology at Troy University, and Mac Brooms on the first day of class said, I walked up to him and I said, I'm changing my major. I'm doing anthropology now. And he said, okay, welcome aboard. So I've been interested in archaeology all my life, and I'm extremely fortunate to be able to do it for a living now.
I mean, that's something everybody I've had on the show so far says to me, that they are fortunate to be doing a job that they not only love, but it's something that they've pretty much always all wanted to do.
For as long as I can remember, I mean, since I was a tiny little kid. When I was a kid, I thought it was just cool and interesting, which it is.
Absolutely.
But now as an adult, I see the need for it. And I think it's kind of I hate to say calling, but I feel like what I do, like what we do as archaeologists, is important. And I try to teach as many people, old and young, as I can about the science and art of archaeology, and why preservation of sticks and bones and rocks and things is important.
So today's topic is Section 106. So what exactly does that mean in terms of archaeology?
Section 106, or the National is Section 106 of the National Historic Preservation Act. That law was passed in 1966 as kind of a reaction to the unbridled progress, I suppose, of the U.S. when we were building the interstate systems and all these things, and then we were growing exponentially. And the public and professionals saw that all these historic sites were being destroyed in the process. And so we said, hang on, there should be some sort of process that you go through to make sure that while you're building this really cool interstate that everybody needs and wants, right, that you're not also destroying the taxpayers' collective, cultural heritage while you're doing it. And so that's essentially how Section 106 came about. It is holding federal agencies responsible for considering what their impacts might be on historic properties when they go to do an undertaking, whether it's themselves building something, giving a permit or a license or funding and granting, something like that. So if the federal agency is ultimately behind any kind of project, they're required to go through this process called the Section 106 process to see if they will impact historic properties.
Yeah, and that's one thing I know people who follow the show, it's something I continuously bring up, is as archaeologists, we have a responsibility to maintain a good relationship with the communities we work in. Destroying someone else's cultural heritage doesn't look good on us.
No, we don't advocate for any one particular group of people over another. We want everyone's stories to be told. We want them to be heard. We want them to be correctly interpreted. And we know that, not that we alone don't have the secret knowledge for that. We want to, let the public in on what we do. We want to educate them. We want to get their input. And for Section 106 purposes, the federal agencies and the archaeologists and other professionals want to get input from the public when a project is coming up. You can't ignore the people whose project, you know, if it's going to be in their community, we need to hear from them.
Yeah. So how does this process work to make sure that everyone is playing by the rules on a project?
Well, there's the way that it's laid out in the law officially, and then there's kind of the way that it plays out in real life. And they're mostly pretty similar, but not maybe to a T. The bottom line is the federal agency, let's say it's the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, is going to put up a cell tower. And so they're going to need to get input from the public. They're going to get input from the State Historic Preservation Office. That's us. They may need to get input from the tribes. And there may be some other parties that come forward that have special knowledge or a special interest in the project. And they can ask the agency, hey, can we participate in this in some way? And the agency will say, yeah, sure, come on. And it is... You find out as much as you can. Are they going to put the cell tower in the middle of a historic district? Is it going to be down the road a ways, but can you still see the tower from the district? Are they going to build the tower on top of an archaeological site? The agency must consider those types of things. And as the state or local representative of the Advisory Council on Historic Preservation in Washington, the state of Alabama, or the State Historic Preservation Office, we advise the agency on what we know and what we think they should or should not do. And the point that I really want everybody to go home with is that the agency is the beginning and the end of the Section 106 project. They are ultimately the entity that says yes or no, or that makes the final decisions.
So that being said, is there any reason that a project wouldn't be subject to Section 106?
For a project to be subject to Section 106, there has to be a federal hook. There has to be that federal backing, the money, the permit, the license, maybe the GSA is building a new federal building. There has to be that federal hook involved. If it's just state money or local money and there's no federal grant or anything like that involved in it, then Section 106 would not apply. But when federal money is used, I'm sure it's no surprise to you that there are some kind of loopholes in which some federally backed projects would be subject to it and some are not. It depends on what they are. The answer to any question in Section 106 is it depends.
So I know this was just a rule of thumb that we had in a historic preservation class I took a few years ago, that if it's something like a building, it has to be at least 50 years old for it to be considered historic.
Right. That's the baseline. That's certainly not saying that all 50-year-old buildings are significant, but you got to start somewhere. You can't, you know, you got to be able to filter out some of them, and 50 years is the cutoff.
So what kind of, projects normally fall under Section 106? I assume it's more than just archaeology here in the state of Alabama.
It is. Archaeology or has the potential to be affected a lot, because we see, on a weekly basis, we get lots of Corps of Engineers permits. Maybe somebody wants to redo their dock. Maybe they want to do a wetland fill to build a subdivision, get a permit to do something, to build a dock in the water or something on, whether it's, you know, in Gulf Shores or on Smith Lake. FCC, every single cell tower that's ever been built theoretically should have gone through the Section 106 process. Doesn't mean it did, but they're supposed to. And you can imagine how something that tall and that big could have a visual impact on, say, the Alabama Capitol building or some other significant building or a historic district or a historic landscape. So I mean, the Department of Transportation has roads and bridges and bridge replacements, and the list goes on and on.
So for those of you looking to attach a dock to our wonderful state house, please don't do that. It's heinous. Nobody wants to look at that. And plus, no one wants you parking your boat up to the state house. That's not okay.
We generally frown upon that.
Yeah, driving your boat through downtown Montgomery, most people, I think, would frown on that, too. That's just my opinion. Because I know traffic, especially in downtown Montgomery or Birmingham, you know, driving a boat through it just makes it worse.
It's hard to believe it could get worse, but that would actually make it worse. So if you could work with us, please, we would appreciate it.
So, yeah, if you're planning on making an addition to your house, like you want to install like a new deck or something, would that still be sectioned to 106 or subject to 106?
Well, it depends on the funding source. If you're getting like a HUD funding for property enhancements or rehabilitation of your property, the Housing and Urban Development, they are a federal agency, so that would be subject automatically no matter what you're doing. The other side of that coin is I live in a house that's listed on the National Register of Historic Places, or my house is within a district on the register. Or somebody told me one time that it was eligible for the register because for Section 106 purposes, a house or a bridge or an archaeological site doesn't have to already be listed on a national register, on the National Register, to be considered significant. It simply has to meet the criteria in order to be considered. Because there'd be all we'd ever do is list properties to the National Register and never do anything else if that were the key. So it only has to be eligible to be listed, and that's what's considered a historic property. So you live in a historic home, do you need a permit? Do you have to do the Section 106 process? It depends. There may be local guidelines that you have to follow for your town. It's for us. Mainly, it's going to depend on the funding source. Where are you getting your money or your permitting? Does the Corps of Engineers have to permit a wetland fill for you to put that sunroom on your house? You know.
Yeah, I have some relatives who've lived in historic districts, and it was more the city than the government being picky about it. Right. They had to use like certain color paints, certain types of metals and certain types of building materials to, it was more about maintaining the aesthetic of the house than it was actually the issue of it violating Section 106, in my opinion.
Right. Section 106 isn't always involved in that. If you live in a historic house, assuming that it doesn't, you still have local guidelines. The local review board will have things to say about it. And I'm sure at some point you signed a document saying you would do these things, or if you wanted to buy a house in here, you would consider doing these things or some such. I don't know how that works because it's not 106, but for 106, theoretically, it's the agency's responsibility to let you know ahead of time. Sometimes the word doesn't get out as quickly as we would like. A lot of people think SHPO is, preservation police. I didn't get a badge or a gun when I started working here, so I can't do any of that. I can't enforce anything.
Unfortunately.
That's a real bummer, honestly. Archaeologists with a badge and a gun, how dangerous is that?
Yeah, I can't see that going well for anyone, really.
Under any circumstances, ever. But again, we facilitate the review because a lot of folks who are getting monies from grants and things like this have never heard of Section 106. They don't know what the advisory council is. They don't think that archaeological sites exist in there where they live. And so they've never heard of a lot of this, and we help them through it. We do a lot of things that the agency maybe should have done or could do, but doesn't have the staff to do. Everybody's underfunded and understaffed, right?
Yeah, that's the curse of doing this type of work. No, not just here in Alabama, it's everywhere, that it is horribly underfunded across the board.
It is. We try to get the word out on, early coordination is key. If you think you're going to be doing X next year, give us a call. You don't have to commit to doing anything. Call us and ask if you think 106 would apply. I can't guarantee anything. I can't give you anything in writing, but I can tell you, we can talk about what if scenarios And at the end of the day, when we get the project from the federal agency, we advise them. We say, hey, as the regional, you know, experts on the historic properties and cultural resources in this area, we think X should happen. And they will either agree or disagree with us. It has happened before that we said, we don't like this. We think you should not give the permit. We think you should not, you know, give them the grant. And they said, thank you for your comments. We're going to do it anyway.
So say people are watching this episode and they want to submit something to Section 106 review. How do they do that?
Well, we have a digital process. We don't even accept stuff via hard copy anymore. It's all digital. We do it through email. I would encourage everybody to go to our website. It's ahc.alabama.gov. And then I would go down to kind of scroll down a little bit to the left-hand side. It says 106 regulatory review. And it has lots of forms and it has articles and things that you can go to and read about Section 106. But it also outlines the process by which we receive Section 106 projects, how long it takes us to review, who you need to send it to, what information we're looking for, and all of that good information. And if you, it should be there, but if you can't find it, call me. I'm happy to walk anybody through the process or answer any questions that they have. I'll try. If I don't know, I'll find somebody who does.
So I know the phrase time is money goes double for archaeologists and historic projects. How long does the review process, I know every project is different and I know it depends. On average, how long does it usually take?
The law says we have to get a response back within 30 calendar days. I shoot for less than that every time. I mean, I'm trying to get, if it's 30 days, I try to get it out in 20. If it were 20 days, I try to get it out in 10, you know. Some projects are super easy and quick, depending on what, like replacing sewer lines in the right of way of a highway. Okay, it's already disturbed. We don't care. We're good with that. That's great. Other projects, you know, a huge bridge spanning a river over Alabama going into Georgia where it involves two states, and we've been talking about it for a couple of years. That's more complicated. But every response will take 30 days or less. However, there might be a ton of responses back and forth, asking for questions, you know, asking for more photographs, asking questions. Maybe we're asking for an archaeological survey or a structure survey to be done before we can answer any questions because we don't know about the area. There's so many variables.
Yeah, that seems to be the case on a lot of, especially state projects. You have to check and then double check everything with not only your own people, but somebody else's people also, because everybody on like a daily basis struggles to be on the same page.
Right. And there's so much going on with the location of structures. People know if there's a structure there generally. Now, if you're buying 1,000 acres, you may not know everything that's on there. So we might ask for a survey to see what's there. Same thing with archaeology. If it's an area that we know that there are sites around or nearby, or if we think it's, you know, based on our training and experience and education, man, this looks like a really great site area for this type of site to exist. We may ask for one because you can't see the archaeology like you can a building. It's in the ground. And then, unless you're Superman with your X-ray vision, we don't know it's there until you get an archaeologist to go out and do a survey and tell us whether there's something there. And then you go through the process of, just because there's something there, is it significant? It may not be.
Yeah, I was just thinking about how easy my life would be if I had X-ray vision to do this kind of work, and I wouldn't have to, you know, tear up 100 acres to find one little ceramic piece in a giant field.
Exactly. I mean, I really feel that way when I'm doing field work in, say, August in South Alabama. Because that's kind of miserable. But the great irony of archaeology, like you mentioned, is you destroy what you love in the process of looking for it, because you can't undig the hole. What if you could theoretically come across something while you're digging those holes, or you know, some kind of feature or something that can't be put back? So it's an awful lot to to look for some small artifacts. Fortunately, we have better technologies than we did even when I started working here 21 years ago. LIDAR is huge. It's been a great help for us. And Google Maps and Google Earth and GIS. And we have all these tools available to us now that I didn't. I was looking at everything with a paper map when I started.
Yeah, I've had a lot of professors, you know, kind of throw that in my face when I can't find something on Google. They're like, well, I had to go to the library and find it on a note card in a stack of like 400 that was written in 1942.
They're not lying, but we've got it easy. I appreciate the fact that we are now spoiled with technology, and I think the field is better for it.
Yeah. So I know this is another thing we have to consider, especially here in Alabama. Would the 106 process change if a project happened to be connected to one of the tribes here or on tribal land?
The process is the same. The key players may be different. There's a difference between whether an undertaking, the action that is being made by the federal agency, whether it will impact, say, ancestral lands or actual currently tribally owned lands. There's a distinction there. As far as an undertaking happening on tribal lands, essentially the tribal historic preservation officer takes on the role of the state historic preservation officer. They would be doing what we do on state lands. Not state lands, but lands within the state that are not on tribal lands. So they would be acting kind of like a SHPO. They would be a TIPO, tribal historic preservation officer. If whatever they're doing, say they wanted to do, I use cell towers a lot because my gosh, we see like 30 of them a week. And they have the potential to affect archaeology and structures. So if they wanted to put a cell tower on the very edge of their tribal land, but it may affect a historic district that's off tribal land, SHPO could request to the advisory council and to the tribe, can we be a consulting party on this? Because it affects us too. It's a negotiation process, and there are lots of ways you can do things. And it's a matter of everybody sitting down together, all the parties or potential parties sitting down together and talking and saying, here's a desired output. How can we get there? There's a lot of compromise. Unfortunately, I can't wave a wand and just say, you're not going to build this XYZ thing. And then the archaeology gets saved. I wish I could.
Yeah, a magic wand in this type of work would be super helpful. It would cut down on project times to like days and hours instead of weeks and months.
It really would. I mean, you know, we don't make a call on the merit of a project. We don't tell you whether we think that bridge needs to be replaced or if there really needs to be a storm shelter right there next to the other one. We don't make those calls. All we're doing is saying, hey, if you're going to do this, let's go through this process first to make sure that we're not using the people's money to destroy the people's heritage.
Yeah. And something that, you know, comes to a lot of archaeologists' minds, especially when you're in more remote projects, all the cell towers that we get approved here in Alabama, and my phone still doesn't work in the middle.
I don't know how that happens. I honestly do not. We see so many of them. So many of those between the FCC and the Corps of Engineers, we do a lot of business. When I say business, we get a lot of projects from them.
Yeah, I was on a project in Tuskegee earlier this week, and you know, I get maybe 30 minutes outside of the city, and boom, my cell phone signal is gone, and I have to wait till I'm actually back on the interstate to actually call anyone to tell them I'm leaving.
Well, there's probably someone out there blaming our office for not approving one because it was next to something historic, but maybe it was a gopher turtle or something. It doesn't necessarily mean it was us.
It was an actual gopher tearing down the cell towers and disrupting projects.
Man, I've heard of some crazy things happening like that.
Yeah, you know, every now and then I'll see a story from a national park or something saying that armadillos are plaguing their park and disrupting historic artifacts.
Oh, I have seen that. I have seen armadillo-induced site damage.
It's really weird when, you know, you get an article from somebody like, hey, our armadillos are tearing up our park and we can't really do anything about that. So we just have to live with it.
There, unfortunately, and especially at 106, there are things that I feel like I just have to live with sometimes. The projects don't always go the way that I wish they would. We don't, like I said, I don't have that gun and badge, so I can't make things go the way that I would like them to go. It's a compromise and it's a process. And sometimes it takes a really long time and it doesn't always end up the way, it doesn't always have a happy ending as far as preservation goes.
So what you're saying is you can't fine the armadillos and the gophers for disrupting historic sites then?
I could, but would they pay?
I mean, not in actual money. Not in actual money. But
no, not just.
Well, Amanda, thank you so much for being here with me today. I hope you all have enjoyed this episode and learned something from it. If people wanted to learn more about Section 106, Amanda, what would you recommend they do?
Three things. I've already mentioned our website. We have lots of links to informative articles and websites on there. Go to the Advisory Council on Historic Preservation's website, achp.gov. They have training and articles and very short bites too about the Section 106 process, what happens when the rules aren't followed, what happens when it's on tribal land. All the what ifs are there on the website, most of them. And I would also recommend, if you want to read a book, Tom King's Federal Planning and Historic Places. He wrote it probably 22 years ago now or more. And it just kind of lays out the process and how it might actually affect somebody. You know, John Smith sitting in his lazy boy, why would he need to care about Section 106 and how could he possibly understand it? And then Tom King's book does that. There are also some citizens guide to Section 106 on the ACHP's website, and they break it down, make it really easy for folks. And hey, I've been doing this a long time and I still have questions almost every day.
We all do. I have questions on a daily basis. Like, if I dig this hole, will I get fined for it?
When in doubt, don't dig.
Will I have to use my one phone call to call my undergraduate professor? Hey, I'm in jail because I was digging a hole. If we could just not talk about this and you just come get me, that would be great.
Yeah, assuming you have cell service way out there in the forest.
I'll be in the one county jail in Alabama that doesn't have cell service and I just have to do my time.
Your luck is like mine.
Well, Amanda, thank you so much for being here with me today. I really appreciate it.
It was a pleasure to be here, and I'm happy to talk to you anytime.
All right. Bye, everybody.
Bye.